Of ecosystem as well as new economic recession we are entering, we are all forced to reevaluate how we think, live, consume, work, and act. In the face of these difficulties, we're not all equal socially, financially, or geographically. When we have the immense chance of working in the creative, artistic, and journalistic industry, when we have the incredible luxury to question and engage, when we have the possibility to exercise what we do in a more meaningful manner, then it becomes our prerogative to live up to this privilege. Too often we're impulsive, we act instinctively without thinking decisions through, and lose sight of the bigger picture. We forego the future for the immediate. I call this the irrelevance of the now. The now, the instant gratification, the immediate need or obsession compensated. The now, or inevitable compression of time, thus thought process and perspective. Filling the void, creating unnecessary noise, hopelessly acting on the instant, we do rather than think. Evermore, we crave distraction, compensate our anxieties with a superficial fix we have unintentionally become accustomed to. Devoted to the immediate, we no longer have the time to self-reflect. Within the context of the now, we must remain awake if we wish to see creativity, undiluted visions, and ideas prevail, protect the freedom to voice opinions, the right to challenge and question what is presented to us, and the need for critical thought and progress. More than ever, we must support, cherish, and celebrate all those who dare, invest in talent and ideas, support all the actors of change and progress for the future of our creative and fashion industry. This season, we introduce two simultaneous experiences of self-service, our usual print version, as well as a film version following the same narration. We wish to creatively embrace the digital age, recontextualizing the narrative of a printed magazine in a multi-layered film experience, expanding our reach and vision beyond boundaries. We want to engage our reader with two ways to experience a magazine, this juxtaposition being our vision for a possible future of magazine publishing.
Girls with Machine Guns by The Cramps. My brother Laurel got me the original 7-inch, and boy oh boy, I was lucky. It came with a poster of the cover. I was so happy I hung it up on the wall of my boarding school room for joy and gladness. And although my teacher said it was inappropriate and asked me to take it off, I never did. Poison Ivy rules. That's it. That's my word.
Prodigy, The Fat of the Land. I love the texture of the image and the colours and how fun the crab looks. It kind of reminds me of the film The Beach. And also everything that's fab about that film, you know, the feeling of being hot and disorientated in the rave and loving it. It's also kind of gross because crabs are a little cute and gross to me. And I like that combination, to be intrigued and repulsed at the same time.
Thank you. qu'elle a toujours été très forte. C'est une artiste visuelle aussi très puissante, mais l'artwork d'Homogénique, il est vraiment très marquant. Je crois que c'est Nick Knight qui a fait la photo. Déjà parce que je trouve qu'il est assez révolutionnaire quand on voit maintenant ce que devient la pop, ce que deviennent les artistes. Björk a été une des premières à travailler la transformation, la mutation, la déréalisation. On est déjà dans une esthétique qui pourrait presque appeler à celle de PC Music aujourd'hui, à celle de Arca. Elle est en train d'annoncer toute une vague de la pop, cyberpop, post-internet pop, quoi, avec une image. Et puis je trouve qu'elle a toujours fait d'elle-même un sujet fascinant de travail. Elle devenait une créature comme ses sons. Donc c'est pareil, c'est aussi une pochette qui contribue à rendre la musique encore plus incroyable. Et c'est, en fait, c'est des pochettes qui dialoguent avec la musique et qui sont pas du tout en train de plaquer une couverture d'album. Ça continue, en fait, d'être un geste créatif jusqu'au bout. Donc, voilà.
Industry is already changing. That's probably why at Marienster we still believe in fashion today. The most important thing we should look up to in the fashion industry is to embrace the world we are living in, being resilient and finding solutions to survive in the best way we can, to be fully conscious in what is around us. That means constant change.
If there is a frame called fashion, my creative dogma is to be at the edge of it. Digitalization will progress further, and the speed of information transmission will become very fast and realistic. I think in the future, it's not the designers who created the style, but the people who wear it. I believe we need to think how to approach those people.
Mi dogma creativo lo defino como una reacción violenta a mi vida diaria. Mis ideales son los que le dan fuerza e identidad a mi marca, así que comprometerlos nunca es negociable.
The industry has to rethink. It's about taking responsibility on so many levels. For me, it's really about embracing the fragility of the moment. I think that's how fashion progresses as well as us as society.
I think the best way to avoid compromising it is just by being super self-critical and constantly questioning the values of what we put out as a product or image or any message. I think just need to keep questioning and questioning and questioning.
We think that brands and individuals who aren't relying on the comfort of going back to an old system will push things forward, and more exciting things will come from that. We hope for a slower, more sustainable, and more personal way of making and buying clothing.
You can never compromise what you believe in. It's always easier to get distracted, and sometimes being distracted sets you on a new journey, one you never anticipated. But the distractions need always help you find your way back to the questions you started asking in the first place. always believe in what it is you're putting out into the world.
Within a creative process, you might have some references or some constants. And so my constant is that, you know, my dogma, it's a constant question to define fashion's relevance with an obsessive confidence in creating good taste.
I would describe my brand as a modern interpretation of India through subversive cuts, layering, texture and colour.
I think the way that we've avoided compromising our personal ideology is really just by like listening to our gut and putting the blinkers on and sort of just trying to focus on what we're trying to achieve and what we're trying to do and not paying attention too much to what everyone else is doing and saying, because, you know, I think it's quite easy to be affected by that and swayed.
I'm just hopeful that everything will change in a positive direction in our industry and the world, and you know, I want to be a part of that change and do whatever I can at Elleeks to do so.
To avoid any compromise, I think I always try to go back to my personal root, personal experience, personal emotion. I think these days emotion sometimes tend to be neglected.
Давай, Игнат, какие твои принципы? Чему ты следуешь?
Ну, типа, здоровому образу жизни. Вот так вот. И все. Кататься на скейтборде хочу.
Это все? Скейтбординг?
Ну да.
Как тебе удается следовать своим принципам и не изменять им?
Меня поддерживают чуваки. Так проще. Когда делают все, чтобы ты не бросал.
Как бы ты описал рассвет? Что для тебя рассвет в двух словах? Коротко просто. Не в двух словах, а коротко. Скейтборд. Ну, что еще?
Все, поездочки, все это весело.
Floyd, Wish You Were Here is one of them albums I actually discovered purely based on the artwork. I came across the picture online somewhere and was just like, this is fucking amazing. You know, the two guys in suits shaking hands and one of them bursting into fire. I just thought it said a lot about, you know, interactions and dealing with people in this world in general, and kind of lives up to all of Pink Floyd's album artwork, which is all just like art in itself, and was the gateway for me into their actual music. The album itself I fucking love. It's like six songs long, which in itself, you know, feels kind of groundbreaking to me. Kind of breaks up the standard format of an album that, you know, we're used to. And I just love it. Like Shine On You Crazy Diamond is an amazing song. Wish You Were Here, the title track. Yeah, sick. Wish You Were Here. Pink Floyd.
Thank you. You got huge eyes. Okay, what do you want me to do about it?
Essie, Fuji.
Can you tag your snap?
I can't be doing that.
Me, I always pick the wrong guy.
It's like conservation of energy. Yeah. Energy in equals energy out, and it just makes sense.
You think it's guys come back.
I don't know how to define it.
So I just say God.
Ooh, what's in the Gucci box?
Just my jewelry.
Everyone's beautiful in their own way.
I just see so many like little things that line up perfectly every day.
What's the most what?
There must be a reason for that.
Lips done.
You get your lips done?
Yeah, I need to. I feel like I need to make it more like protruded.
No picture, no ad back. I wish I had that many friends. What's your favourite food? I'm not sure.
I don't want to be addicted to it though. It's so common now.
I feel like so many people have them. Like, obviously, I know I'm one of them, but.
Are you married? Yeah, because I'm married at the age of 18.
No, I'm not married.
Betrayed. How?
I used to listen to rock.
Like grunge. Rock. Like what era of rock? You're savage.
Same love, not exactly.
Same love.
You guys keep giving me likes. I enjoy it.
I wonder how some people manage to change their own beliefs, because I try to do things that I deeply identify with. I guess it comes from remaining loyal to my own vision and my own beliefs. It just happens naturally. I try to be true to myself, to what I think is the right thing to do, to what I think it's a progressive way to see the world. That's my main commitment with myself as an editor, as a publisher, and as a person. It's actually pretty easy. I do things I believe in, and the things I don't believe in, well, usually I avoid them.
A lot of good independent press is about creating time capsules, because the digital world is all fine and dandy and serves its purpose. But I would be hard-pressed to remember anything that went on in the digital world in the past 10 years. The beauty of what we do when we commit things to paper is that it becomes a small-time capsule and something that you could go back to, look at again, think about in 30 years' time. These will probably be documents that will still be available, whereas I have this strange feeling that a lot of the digital content would have disappeared in the ether.
There are only a couple of really great magazines out there, and why is that? Because simply, intelligence has completely evaporated in our industry. If you are young and smart and ambitious today, you probably don't go into print media. But then, why are we still publishing a magazine? Because it's a source of energy and a research tool for us that enables us to do all the other activities.
I think what particularly inspired me this next issue of Love was working with new people that I hadn't worked with before, people that had never really been given a break. There was definitely an elite clique of photographers, stylists, hair and makeup, the most acclaimed model of the day. And what happened this year was the clique got destroyed. You couldn't put those people in a room no matter how hard you tried. So we had to rip it up and start again.
What does it mean doing a magazine today? It's a very complicated question. To me, a magazine is an open space. It's a landscape. And today people don't look at landscape. They look at images, at fragmented images. Their need for picture is endless. And with each picture, the time is disintegrated. When you edit a magazine, you don't destroy, you don't deconstruct, or you don't disintegrate the time. You open it, you open the time, you give a perspective. This is what people call vision.
We felt an overwhelming need to make something that felt really free and challenge the boundaries of what print publishing could be. In the 60s and 70s, magazines were more exploratory than now, and today everybody's stuck in a very rigid format where we do the same thing month after month. We wanted to try something new to challenge that and create something less limited.
The intrinsic quality of the printed magazine is in its physicality and the fact that it's a product in a stable world. And it's offline and you cannot leave a like or a comment. And when I think about the magazine itself as a magazine maker, it's a collaborative effort and a dialogue with so many people, so it doesn't exist completely in isolation. It's great to have feedback through digital, but it got very toxic this past year. Everybody I'm speaking to has real digital anxiety.
And that influence of just being able to have a vision of what you want, even if it's fashionable or not, is actually really much more important, and I guess by default becomes more influential to a lot of people. Fast forward to our time now and lockdown and the necessity to simplify our lives around what has meaning is even more pertinent. It forces a level of honesty across everything, which is what I really like.
I felt a huge responsibility since the day I took this position at the magazine. Responsibility to the community, responsibility to the brand and its heritage, but also responsibility to the culture. Fashion's our vehicle to really comment on what's happening culturally. And obviously there's so much to be said right now. It's important for us to really harness what's going on in the street. That's what ID's always been about, talking about the big picture and really celebrating the underdog.
Everybody is publicly judged on Instagram, so as a publisher, we definitely have to make sure that everything has to be considered and it has to be more democratic, more fair, more representative of different nationalities and cultures. I'm glad it's a more political time in a way, because actually it also produces more interesting content.
It really was a way of sharing all the road trip experiences with the world. With the people I wanted to see, people I wanted to impress, people I wanted to befriend, people I wanted to excite. I guess that is what the root reason for making a magazine was.
I suppose art and culture allows people to discover new worlds and make new lives and escape. In this new social distance world, what a magazine can bring feels even more powerful. I think creatively it's important to have things that aren't necessarily fully understandable, but are amazing and provoke. Art can really capture a moment and open our imaginations and stimulate intellectual debate. It can be elitist in culture, but it can go on to become popular culture, opening ideas and challenging the status quo.
Anyway.
but somehow.
I think it's just naturally in you that you're interested in many things. You know, you're interested in life, you're interested in whatever it is. You're interested in sport, you're interested in culture, you're interested in hiking in the mountains, you're interested in eating well, you're interested in having conversations with people. And as long as you're open within the world, and also for me, also looking forward, but also looking backwards from where you come from, you know, and I draw a lot from where I come from my family, from where I live closely next to the forest. And as long as all that comes together, and as long as you're alive and you're jaded in life and you're excited about doing things, that's when inspirations come. And they come to you, really. My biggest things come up when I let go, when I don't sort of search manically for, I don't know what to do, and I'm looking around, and da, da, da. Then nothing really comes. Once you're free and you're relaxed, things come to you because you're opening up, and that's what it is.
Breakfast at the Holiday Inn Hotel, where I live ordinarily, especially where I live in other places. I look forward to breakfast.
We feel that a big part of the recognition we get all of a sudden is in reality the astonishment of the establishment that we are still existing. And this with the deliberate decision of not wanting to grow in size.
Like just about to actively create the moment we would like to live in with all that is at hand at present, and then we just add the missing through creation. It's some sort of a communication through situation design, we would call it eventually.
I
I first saw this album when I was aged about 7 or 8. I used to get terrible asthma attacks and quite often would have to stay at home ill and not go to school. And I remember looking through my parents' record collection, and at that kind of age, you pick things purely based on how they look. And this album cover just looked like the coolest thing I'd ever seen. At that time, I was also into drawing comics, and so I not only would like listen to this album, but I would also try and draw the same image, and particularly like their Converse shoes. I would that's how I started drawing shoes after seeing this album. Not only does it have some brilliant artwork depicting a sort of, I don't know, like a destroyed post-apocalyptic New York in the background, and the Ramones still rocking.
Ah! I often see younger photographers that I'm walking with, or out shooting or something like that, and every time they make a shot, they look at the back of the camera to see what the shot looks like. But meanwhile, the action that was in front of them is still unfolding, and they've already missed what it was becoming because they stopped to look at what they already did. They're already in the past instead of in the continuing present. And I think that that's a kind of mindset that breaks a rhythm, an intuitive rhythm that is necessary to watch as the world shows itself to you and is in an evolving moment. It's becoming something else. And only your attention, your consistent attention, is going to take you to that next step, which could be a much better photograph. So I say, don't let the immediacy of the digital camera and the racy conditions of internet life draw you away from your purpose. And the purpose is to be present in the moment. Photography is such a Zen arrow. It's always in the moment. The photograph is always now. It's always present tense. And I think if one understands the richness of present tense, the work will live longer in the future because it will always be present tense, but it will also relate to the past moment that it was made in. So these two things of being really present and containing the past are elemental to photographic purpose, from the way I see it.
This hyper-present vocabulary, prevalent across multiple identity and content-producing platforms, is now so integral and ingrained within us, it has become second nature. At a time when the moral bankruptcy of mass media and politics proliferates, and image and content are warped to deceive, artists' use of this medium provides an essential port of reflection. Each of the artists within this portfolio center the politicized nature of contemporary imagery, quotation, and technology's role in image-making. Free from the majority of the constraints of the regular use economy, the visual arts provides an interstitial space. It's a space free to forefront essential voices and ideas. Nothing is off limits, and with that, there is both a new freedom and a vulnerability, a generative vulnerability that allows for questions to layer like sediment. Artists' acute observations of this time have never been more needed.
What's up? Hi again.
She turned me into a wild beast, right? I don't say that I am a wild beast all the time, but I'm a wild beast some of the time.
This is a, I could call it a gem. It is a small object made out of one piece of wood. It comes from Nigeria, from the Yoruba. It is most certainly 19th century. It is a cup for divination purposes. If you look at this artist, there are quite a few things which are specific to him. First of all, he turned the head to the side, which is a very unusual but very elegant gesture. Secondly, the way he carved the skull, which is thinned out, turned and sort of narrow towards the back, is almost like Nefertiti. You see the arms here, how the hands merge within the cup and kind of disappear from being wrapped for so many decades. And I think it's certainly, as an object, one of the finest divination cups from the Yoruba I know.
Yeah.
It's not often that I kind of want to think of my career in terms of, you know, this whole journey. I tend to think of what I want to do next. But often there's a sort of a sense of agitation from what I've done the day before that pushes me towards wanting to do something. It feels at least as I'm stretching myself, trying to uncover a new layer. But I think, you know, in all honesty, I think there's a thread. There is definitely a sort of signature, not necessarily a signature image, but there's a signature within the work that has continued and has been consistently there throughout. And it may be that it's hard for people to see because it's obscured by this kind of constant repositioning and a sort of revision on the way to say sort of more or less the same thing. I sometimes think it's like that sort of, you know, that story of the dog that's looking, going around looking for its tail. I suppose really the compelling or the romantic component to that is this idea that you're seeking something which probably in truth is never going to be discovered or found, but you're looking for it in the hope that you might land on something that puts a full stop on the journey. And I think that all those notions are constantly sort of acting on me to just try to take it, what ostensibly I suppose in a slightly abstract way feels for me like that it's an attempt to create some kind of melody, this sort of like you know, this note even that I can sort of stretch and turn around and use in different ways, and that medium is very flexible, so it allows me to do that.
Thank you.